Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to invite you to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 this morning, please. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, we're going to start reading in verse 11 of that context, if you'll open there. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 11. Paul says the following, 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 11, "Therefore encourage one another and build one another up, just as you also are doing. But we request of you, brethren, that you appreciate those who diligently labor among you and have charge over you in the Lord and give you instruction, and that you esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Live in peace with one another, and we urge you, brethren, admonish the unruly, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all men." I want you to see something that's a common denominator in all of those admonitions that Paul gives to the Thessalonians here in 1 Thessalonians 5. I want you to see that in each entreaty, he's talking about the power of words, is he not? Do you see the place of communication and all those things that he says? Look back with me again. He says in verse 11, encourage one another, build one another up. He says, appreciate those who diligently labor among you. Isn't words going to be an element of how that's expressed? He says, esteem them very highly in love because of their work. That's going to be communicated, right? He says, live in peace with one another. That's going to require words, isn't it? Sometimes words of forgiveness. Sometimes words of entreaty for reconciliation. He says in verse 14, we urge you, brethren, admonish. That's communication. Encourage. Help. That might involve service as well, but there's words in that. And patience, he says, with all people. Sometimes that means holding your tongue, right? The thing that I want you to see in all of those, though, is that he's talking about words. He's talking about how we communicate with each other. And I want to give some attention this morning to just thinking about words that edify, and about us being purposeful and thoughtful in communicating words that edify to the people around us. Words that edify to each other, words that edify our family, words that edify our spouses, words that we can use in our interactions day to day with people. He obviously, in those communications that we just read about there, is talking about the responsibility that we have with each other to speak words that edify, words that build up. I want you to see in the word edify, the word edifice. You know what an edifice is? An edifice is a building. An edifice is something that's been constructed. And so when you build an edifice, you use some kind of raw materials. It's blocks, or it's metal, or it's lumber. But you use some kind of raw materials that you craft, you cut, and you measure, and you put them together in such a way that they end up in some kind of beautiful and useful design. And when we use words with each other, they need to be crafted in the same way. They need to be carefully measured. They need to be carefully cut. They need to be put together in such a way that they bring about some kind of purpose that is beautiful when it's over with. And so we need to think in terms of how we use our tongues and how we use our words, that we can say things that are beautiful, that build up, things that are constructive in their intent. It might be an admonition, but it's a constructive admonition. The intent in the end is construction. It's not destruction. It's to build up. It's to result in something that's beautiful. And I want to say to every one of us, without exception, your words are powerful. It doesn't matter how old you are or how young you are. It doesn't matter if you're a man or if you're a woman. It does not matter if you are naturally extroverted or if you are naturally introverted. I want to say to you that your words are powerful. And part of what makes them powerful is that it's something that you have with you all the time. I mean, you carry your tongue with you every day, right? And you bring it into every interaction, into every situation. You have the potential to use your words to make a difference in every encounter through the day. And so I want you to appreciate the fact that God has given you the power to make a difference with the words that you speak every day. And if you are extroverted, there are some ways in which that potentiality might be even diminished because people expect you to say something. They expect you to speak up. And because of that, there is an extra sort of responsibility in that regard to really be thoughtful and to really be measured about what you say so that you're not just talking for talking's sake or that you're not just talking with the wrong kind of motivation because of what esteem or what glory or what you might show or share about your own intelligence or about your own wit. And so there needs to be care taken for how you communicate if you're naturally given to extroversion. If you are a naturally introverted person, I want you to appreciate about how particularly powerful your words are. When you speak, people are not accustomed or they're not expecting you to speak. And so there is extra power in that. There's punch to what you say that might not exist for someone else. And so you can say some things plainly or you can say some things simply. But I tell you, when you say something, people listen and it's meaningful. And so I just want to underline that for all of us, whoever you are, your words have power and your words have meaning. One of the great things that we find in the book of 1 Thessalonians, and the reason I brought us here, is that Paul illustrates in his own language, in his own communication to these Christians, words that edify. And we find, in fact, some great edification starters, is what I want to call them, in the book of 1 Thessalonians. He gives us some great things that we can say when we look for what to say to edify. In fact, don't get nervous when I tell you how many. I'm going to give you a list of 12 things that you can say. I know that means we got to go fast, but 12 things that you can say that are edifying. 12 great edification starters. These would be great to write down. Or they'd be great to, you might find one or two of them that's something that you can add to your edification repertoire that you can pull out in order to be a builder-upper with the people around you. Paul, as he's writing to the Thessalonians, he's writing to people that are new Christians. If you go back to the book of Acts in chapter 16, this is where he came to Thessalonica and where he evangelized that community. He wasn't there very long because persecution drove him out of the city. So he had just a short time there. And it seems that shortly after his departure is when he wrote this book because he was worried about these new Christians, these babes in Christ. And so 1 Thessalonians is a great primer of how you ought to treat a new Christian, about what you ought to do with babes in Christ and the things that you need to say to them. But it's a great tool as well and a great primer as well in finding good things that we can say to other people that build them up. And so I want you to hear some of the edification starters that Paul gives us in this great epistle. First of all, notice with me, if you would, chapter 1 and verse 2, chapter 1 and verse 2, where Paul says the following to the Thessalonians. He says, "We give thanks to God always for all of you, making mention of you in our prayers." Now, I want you to see how that theme carries over into chapter 2 and verse 13, where he says the following. "And for this reason, we also constantly thank God that when you receive from us the word of God's message, you accepted it not as the word of men, but for what it really is, the word of God, which also performs its work in you who believe." One of the things that you can express to other people that is very edifying is to express to them how you thank God for them, your thanks for them. And I want you to see that how Paul does that. He says in chapter 1, verse 2, in a generic way, that we thank God for you. But when he gets to chapter 2 and verse 13, he doesn't just say, "We thank God for you." He tells them why we thank God for you. And so he gives the reason. Now, I want you to appreciate the power of that. First of all, One of the great edifying things that you can say to your wife is, "I thank God for you." Or to your kids, "I thank God for you every day." If your brother or your sister in Christ comes to you and says, when I pray, I thank God for you, would that mean something to you? That's meaningful, isn't it? To say to someone who's a friend or a coworker who's not a believer, that I thank God for you. I thank God that you're my employer. I thank God that you are you're on my team because of the difference that you make in my day. That's powerful. But it is especially powerful when you give them the reason why. Like, don't just tell them that you thank God for them. Tell them why you thank God for them. Tell them what you say to God about them. And that's the beauty of what Paul says in chapter 2 and verse 13, is he gives them the why. He tells them what he says to God about them. It's a great way for you to edify someone else. And so if I could give you kind of a starter for how you do that, it's very simply this. I give thanks to God for you because fill in the blank. You write that in a card. I give thanks to God for you because. Use that as a starter in a face-to-face conversation with someone. I give thanks to God for you because. And then you fill in the blank. Secondly, I want you to see in chapter 3 and verse 10, something else that Paul says to them that's something that he says to God. So he says in chapter 3 and verse 10, he says, as we night and day keep praying most earnestly that we may see your face and may complete what is lacking in your faith. Paul not only expresses thanks to God for them, Paul also expresses petitions to God for them. Is that edifying? When people tell you that they're praying for you, is that edifying? That's a great builder-upper, is it not? And when we do again what Paul does here, when he specifies what he prays, he doesn't just say, I'm praying for you. And there's nothing wrong with simply saying to someone, I'm praying for you. And they may already know why it is that you're praying. But when you tell them what you're praying, there's power in that. And so I want to encourage you to the specificity of telling someone in a card or someone in a face-to-face, this is the thing that I'm saying to God about you or on your behalf. And as a way to just say that and fill in the blank is this. I am asking God to blank for you. I am asking God to, and then you fill in the blank, for you. What is that? If you will use those words with people, it will be powerful in the way that you edify them. Look, if you would, at chapter 2 and verse 14. Chapter 2 and verse 14. Paul writes here, he says, for you, brethren, became imitators of the churches of God in Christ Jesus that are in Judea, for you also endured the same sufferings at the hands of your countrymen, even as they did from the Jews. One of the things that Paul says to them here that's edifying is he gives his endorsement of them. He gives us his endorsement of them. He says, this is what I see in you. This is what you have become. And he uses that by drawing an analogy between their experiences and the experience of other brethren in other places who suffered for the cause of Christ. And he says, this is what you became when I look at you. He said, you became imitators of the churches of God in Christ that are in Judea. They were the first to be persecuted. And now these Christians, he says, are following in their footsteps. That's a very encouraging thing to say to somebody. You know, I have been watching you, and this is what I see in you. This is how you've changed. This is how what you've become. And are people encouraged when you notice their progress? When you notice the transformation of their life? When you acknowledge things that are in their character? When you endorse those things? That's a very building up way to speak to somebody. And so Paul talks about the things that he says in them. The way that you can say that to someone is that you have become, and then fill in the blank. What have they become in your eyes? Or you can say, I have watched you, and this is what I see in you. That's edifying. And it's a great way that you can start an edifying statement to someone. Look at chapter 1 and verse 8. Chapter 1 and verse 8. And here Paul shares the news that he's received about them. He shares the news that he's received about them. He says in verse 8 of chapter 1, "For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone forth, so that we have no need to say anything." Verse 9, "For they themselves report about us, what kind of reception we had with you, and how you turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God, and to wait from his son, or wait for his son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, that is Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come." One of the things that Paul says that's very encouraging to them is he tells them what other people are saying about them. He says, "This is what I'm hearing. This is the words that other people are telling me about you, and I want to share that with you." And that's something that you can share with other people. When you hear encouraging things, or when you hear edifying things, or when you're aware of their good reputation, either among the brethren or in the community, when you share that, that is edifying. That builds other people up. And Paul uses that kind of strategy in his encouragement of them. You can start that by saying something like this: "I hear people say this about you. I hear people say this about you." And then you fill in the blank, whatever that this is. Look at chapter 2 and verse 19. 2 and verse 19, Paul says there, "For who is our hope or joy or crown of exaltation? Is it not even you in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming?" Paul there tells them what he sees their future being. He tells them what he sees for them in the future. And one of the edifying things that you can do, or one of the edifying things that you can say to someone, is to describe to them your vision for them. Your vision for them. What you see in their future. When you take their present character and their present progress, when you see what their life and what their heart looks like, this is what you see as being their future. And Paul describes that picture for them in words that are meaningful to them. He sees them present at the judgment day. And he sees the joy that he's going to experience when he sees them there. And he communicates to that to them in a way that's powerful. And you don't have to go all the way to the judgment day. You don't have to go all the way to glory to talk about what you see in someone's future. But that's certainly one of the things that you can describe. But you can say to somebody, "This is what I see. This is what I see in you." As we pursue God's hand in raising up shepherds among us, those are conversations that you need to be having with our brothers that you see in that role, isn't it? I see you as being a shepherd here. These are the qualities that I see in you. These are the things that I see in you that will make you great in that role. And so that's one of the great ways that you can help someone in their aspiration is to describe to them what you see in them in that way. It's a great way to encourage a child who has strengths in a particular area that I can see you doing this someday. I had folks that said those kinds of things to me when I was a kid, and I still remember things that teachers said, or things that brothers in Christ said to me who mattered to me. And they said things to me that set me on a pursuit, on a path. Have you ever experienced that? It's powerful. And so telling someone else your vision of them is a great way to encourage them. I see you is the way you might begin that. I see you accomplishing this, doing this, being this, is the way you would start a sentence or a statement like that. Chapter 2 and verse 20. Chapter 2 and verse 20. It's a simple statement, but I want you to see the power in it. Verse 20, Paul says, "For you are our glory and our joy." For you are our glory and our joy. Now, that may not seem like a big deal, but I want you to see the big deal that kind of statement is. Paul is describing there to them his reliance on them. You are my joy. You are my glory. You're what makes me proud. You're what makes me, you are what brings meaning to my life and purpose to my life. You are our glory and our joy. When you tell someone how it is that you rely on them, or what source they are to you, if they're a source of refreshment, if they're a source of encouragement, if they're a source of conviction, if they're someone who always speaks the truth to you when you need it, if they are someone who there's someone who brings you happiness, communicating to someone that you are this for me is an encouraging way to communicate. It tells them how you rely on them, how it is that you count on them. And it also brings a certain amount of accountability to keep it up when you speak to someone in that way. So you can say to someone, you are my, and then fill in the blank. What are they? Are they your sunshine? Are they the happiness in your day? Are they your encourager? Are they your inspiration? Fill in the blank. What are they to you? You are my. And the ownership of that, the possessiveness of saying that you are this to me, is the thing that makes that edifying. Think of how God does that for us when He says, you are my children. You are my sons and my daughters. You are my, He uses words like, you are my joy. You are my beloved. You are my chosen. You are my priest. You are, there's so many terms that God uses to describe the relationship that we have with Him that's intended to be an encouragement for us, that's intended to be edifying or building up. So you can say, you are my, fill in the blank, or you give me, and then tell them what they're the source of for you. Number seven, you can describe to them what your memories of them are. Look at chapter 1 and verse 3. Chapter 1 and verse 3. When Paul talks about how he prays or how he gives thanks to God for them, he says in verse 3 that I'm constantly bearing in mind your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ and in the presence of God, of our God and our Father, knowing, brethren, beloved by God, His choice of you. I just want you to notice in verse 3 how he's bringing to mind the things that he recalls about them. He says, I'm constantly bearing in mind, I'm constantly thinking about your work of faith, your labor of love, and your steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. One of the great ways that you can edify someone is you can say that when I think of you, I recall this. When I think of you, I think of this. When I think of you, I think of your great faith. I think of how you travail in the midst of difficult times. I think of how you always keep an optimistic attitude. I think about how you say the right thing at the right time. I think about how you're always there for people that need help or that need assistance. I think about you rushing to their side. Telling someone your memories of them is a great way to edify or to encourage them. Look at chapter 2, and Paul spends a great deal of time doing this. Chapter 2, verse 1, he says, for you yourselves know, brethren, that our coming to you was not in vain, but after we had already suffered and been mistreated in Philippi, as you know, we had the boldness in our God to speak to you the gospel of God amid much opposition. And he goes on to describe his shared experiences with them when he was preaching in the city of Thessalonica. One of the encouraging things, or one of the edifying things that you can say to people is you can recollect shared experiences with them. Do you remember the time when you have someone recently started a conversation like that with you? Do you remember when? And then they go on to relate something that you all did together. When I wrote my mom for Mother's Day, and I said, Mom, I remember. And every time Mother's Day comes around, I think about this one time when Mom, she did this for like a couple weeks, where when we got home from school, she had this list of, they were chores that we had to do, but she made them fun. And so when you did this chore, then you'd find some kind of clue or some kind of instruction about the next thing that you were to do. And so it was kind of like a scavenger hunt. And when it was all over with, and she had some kind of treat or something in the freezer, she'd made some fudge or did something that was kind of a reward at the end. It was a little thing, but I still remember that from growing up, and it is so it is such a statement of who my mom is. I mean, that's just, those kinds of things are who she is. And not just with us, but it's just the way she is with everybody. And so telling her that, saying, I remember, or do you remember, is edifying. Because it's a shared experience that is a compliment to their character. And one of the reasons I thank God for my mom. And so when you recall a memory or a shared experience with someone, it's a great way to edify them. Look at chapter 2 and verse 17. Chapter 2 and verse 17. Paul there says, but we brethren, having been bereft of you for a short while in person, not in spirit, were all the more eager with great desire to see your face. A very simple thing that you can say to somebody that is meaningful or that is edifying to them is to describe to them your longing for them. That when you're not around, I feel this. When I don't get to see you, this is what I experience. It's the opposite of talking about the virtue that you see in somebody. You know, you're describing their value because you tell them what's missing when they're missing. What you're not experiencing when they're not there. And that's a great way to tell somebody how valuable they are, is to describe what's missing when you're not with them. You're longing for them. And so Paul describes that for them. He says, we've been bereft of you for a short while, but it doesn't feel short, he says. We've been bereft in person, but not in spirit, because our hearts cry out and we earnestly long to see you. He uses such fervent language as he describes his longing for them. And so you can start that by saying, when we're apart, I feel, and then you fill in the blank. Look at chapter 3 and verse 1. Chapter 3, verse 1. Paul says, therefore, when we could endure it no longer, he's still talking about missing them. When we could endure it no longer, we thought it best to be left behind at Athens alone, and we sent Timothy, our brother and God's fellow worker in the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you as to your faith. One of the encouraging things that you can say to someone is to tell them the plans that you make because of them. When you describe your plans, the plans that you make because of them. And now, the way Paul does it here is he describes, this is what we did because we missed you so much. Because we so longed to see you and we couldn't get there. This is what that motivated us to do. We were motivated to send Timothy so that he could come and check on you and make sure everything was okay. But when you tell someone that because of you, I decided to do this. Because of your influence in my life, because of what you mean to me, I was motivated, I was inspired to do this, to take this on, or to pursue this. That's encouraging when people know how they've been a motivator for you, how they've inspired you in some way. And so one of the great encouraging things that you can say to someone is to describe the plans that you've made that are connected to them and to their influence. You have motivated me too. You have inspired me too. And then you fill in the blank. Number 11. Look at verse 9. See, I told you it wouldn't take too long. Verse 9. He says, for what thanks can we render to God for you in return for all the joy with which we rejoice before our God on your account? One of the encouraging things that you can say to someone is to describe your exuberance in them. What I mean by exuberance is that when you tell someone that I am over the top about you for this reason, and it's going to be in words like what Paul expresses here, when you're at a loss for words to say, to express appreciation, that's encouraging. When you're tongue-tied because you're trying to tell someone how much they mean to you, that is meaningful to people. And so Paul says, what thanks can we give? How can we thank God enough for you? And so when you say to someone, I can't say enough about this. I can't say enough about this quality of yours. When you speak in words that communicate your exuberance over them, the superabundance that you receive from them, that is an encouraging way. And listen, folks, we need to, let's not be reserved. Let's not be reserved in expressing our affection. I'm afraid sometimes we have the notion that God has in mind for us in our relationships with each other to be the humility police. You know, my job is to make sure that you don't get too uppity, that you don't feel too good about yourself, to make sure I bring you down a notch when your feet are getting off the ground. That is not my job is to edify you. It's not to humble you. God will humble you, and you need to keep yourself humble. But my job is to build you up. And building others up is a humbling thing. I mean, people are humbled when you build them up. And so we need to be practiced in that kind of skill and be exuberant in our expression. Not flatterers, not people who make merchandise or manipulate other people with our words, but say words that are sincere and words that are intended to build up. Finally, I want you to see in chapter 4 and verse 1, and there's a good bit of this in the book of Thessalonians, but it doesn't begin until chapter 4 and verse 1. One of the things that we can say to people that edifies them is we can express to them our exhortations. We can express to them our exhortations. And so in verse 1 of chapter 4, Paul says, "Finally then, brethren, we request and exhort you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us instruction as to how you ought to walk and please God, just as you actually do, that you may excel still more." And so he goes on to admonish them to be pure. Look at verse 3. "For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that is that you abstain from sexual immorality." So he tells them to be pure. He tells them to love. He tells them to be mindful of their reputation. He tells them to trust God and be comforted in His promises. He tells them to remember that the Lord is coming and to be sober and to put on their armor. He tells them to honor their leaders. He tells them to be peaceful and patient. He tells them to be forgiving. He tells them to rejoice in the Lord always. He tells them to pray. He tells them a lot. He tells them a lot. But I want you to see how he tells them a lot. He first builds them up. He first builds them up. And when you build people up, when people know that you love them, you can tell them anything. But when they don't know that you love them, you can't tell them anything. They don't want to hear from you. But when they know that you love them, you can tell them, you can say anything to your wife. Maybe not, maybe that's a bad example. But you can say a lot more than if she doesn't know that she's loved. But when folks know that you love them, then you can say anything to them. And I want you to see how Paul expresses that. When he expresses his exhortations to them, he says, this is God's will for you. I want you to see how he uses that language to the rest of the book. He talks about, he builds the premise, not this is what I want from you or this is what I think. He says everything that he says in the rest of the epistle, this is God's will for you. And so how could I admonish you to be any different from this? What else could I recommend to you than the will of God? This is what God wants for you. This is His will for you. And they're able to receive it because Paul started with saying these 11 things that prep them for the things that he needs to say to them that represent changes that are needed in their life, ways in which they needed to excel still more and more. So did you get all those down? You got them filed away? When you speak to someone, you can edify them by expressing your thanks, by expressing your prayers, by expressing your endorsement of them, by telling them what others are saying about them, by giving them your vision for their future, by telling them about your reliance on them, by expressing your memories, your shared experiences together, your longing for them, the plans that you make because of them, your exuberance in them, and your exhortations to them. All of those are encouraging ways to behave. So, take those, because you are an encouraging people. You are an edifying people. But take those, and as Paul says to the Thessalonians, excel still more and more, abound still more and more, because there's some way that we can improve in that regard. And there's great power in your words. Take your words this week and go build somebody up. We all can do that. Build somebody up today. Build somebody up this week. Take your words and go make a difference. Go be light. Go be salt. God has given you the potential to do that because He's given you a tongue. And He's given you a mind. And so use that tongue and that mind in thoughtful ways to edify people, so that the will of the Lord is done in their life. As we sing together this morning, I'm praying that the Lord will convict your heart if you're in need of His gospel and of His salvation this morning. I'm praying that He'll work on your heart to make you mindful of His love and of His grace and of His desire for you. So that if you're not one of His followers this morning, that you'll want to be, as together we stand and as we sing. Father God.